This podcast is part of the Game and Entertainment Network. Visit tgenetwork.net to find the latest episodes from all our shows.
Welcome back to Couch Potatoes. This is episode number 92. I'm your host, Islane, and I'm joined by my co-host, Ari, on this, our special anniversary episode.
I hate Izzy so, so much.
Yes, I forgot to hit the record button, so we're starting over from about, 10 minutes in.
And they're not going to hear my awesome rendition of the Pokemon song now.
Oh.
Just imagine me singing, but amazing. And there you go.
Insert Pokemon theme song here.
All right, I'll do it. I want to catch them all. You know it's my destiny, Pokemon. Oh, you're my best friend. In a world we must defend Pokemon. Ow! All right, back to Izzy.
With that said, sorry about the delay in getting this episode to you. We had some scheduling issues with Dune, and then I took a vacation, and didn't plan very well to get something out. We're hoping that this episode is going to be long enough that we can split it into two, and I am recording again this weekend with Tactics. Hopefully Ari's going to be able to make that one, but if she can't, I'll give her some time off. And we'll get some content out to you guys, and hopefully it'll be like we never left. With that said, this episode we are going to be doing a recap of basically every episode that we've done up to this point. We might skip over a couple that maybe don't have anything that relevant to add, but I just basically wanted to see if we had any sort of changes of heart or different ideas about things that we've said and covered in the past.
Changes.
Yes. With that said, let's get into what we've been playing. So, Ari, we already know that you've been playing Pokemon. Tell us about Pokemon Go.
It's fucking Pokemon. As I said before, it is a swear word inducing game because it's just Pokemon. You can't not say it's fucking Pokemon. So yeah, it's Pokemon.
It's fucking Pokemon.
And, like, it's, the mechanics are like kind of a little off right now. I think they're going to be improving the game probably as it goes. Like, it's not as, say, in depth as like Ingress, a game by the same people, but it's got enough there to, you know, keep you going. And it's Pokemon, and it's the original Pokemon. It's not all the shit Pokemon.
There's like, shit Pokemon?
Yeah, of course there's shit Pokemon. Everything after the first 150 Pokemon. 151 are shit. There you go. I said it. Fight me, bro.
I have no idea. I've never played Pokemon.
Well, like, the first game, I loved this game. I played it on my Game Boy. Amazing. I love that game so much. Like, just capturing Pokemon, battling the random NPCs, going to the gyms and getting gym badges, all that kind of stuff. It was actually a really, really good game. And then they have the TV show playing at the same time, which was amazing. So many feels. And then they made a game. Like, the entire time that Pokemon has been alive, I think people have really wanted just a real life Pokemon. You know what I mean? Walk around, capture Pokemon, battle random people, that kind of stuff. And now
makes
we have
sense.
It's fucking Pokemon.
I think it seems cool for the health benefits.
Like, billions of dollars. I can already see it.
And as I said before, I think it may be the thing that helps save America from obesity.
Yeah.
The health benefits are good. Being able to get out there and walk around, do things like that. It kind of reminds me of geocaching, which is what I had asked on Twitter.
That's kind of exactly what it is. Yeah.
Yeah. Essentially the same sort of deal, except for nobody's putting
Ingress,
it there. It's the program.
Well, a few companies are making those games. In Ingress, the people making Pokemon Go have a game like that already. Like, you're controlling certain areas and defending nodes and all that kind of stuff. And they've kind of made, like, a Pokemon variant. It's not as complicated, as I said, but it's still something. And I think, as I've
they may
with
add
Ingress,
to it.
Yeah, like with Ingress, they have improved upon it over time, so we probably see that as well. I hope we have, like, actual real-life, like, Pokemon competitions. That'd be hilarious. I really do hope they improve the combat mechanic in it, though.
But the only way you can get the 150 first is if you climb Mount Everest.
Yeah, I would die if I do that, sorry. I would get to the foot of Everest, and then my lungs would give out.
Probably.
My asthma's freaking terrible lately, so yeah, it's not gonna happen. It's good. It's Pokemon. It's fucking Pokemon, man. It's fucking Pokemon. Gonna catch up. Oh... Can I just sing that song for the entire episode? It'd be awesome.
No.
All right. I've been playing lots of Tomb Raider as well. Rise of the Tomb Raider, the second one, the new one. Well, newish. It was a decent price on the Steam sale, so I picked it up, and I've been playing it nearly the entire time afterwards.
Steam sale.
I think I spent about $200 on the Steam sale.
I don't think I came anywhere near that, but maybe 100.
Well, there was Tomb Raider 40, and then there was the game that somebody wanted me to purchase.
Yeah.
That I bought as well for $40. That hasn't
We're done.
That hasn't played with me yet, called Borderlands, the pre-sequel. And I got a whole heap of other games too. Like I got Titan Souls and Dreamfall Chapters and Chroma Squad and 80 Days and Momodora and Not a Hero and Steamworld Heist and Sorcery and Solus Project. And I think there's something else as well. So yeah, I actually got a shitload of games.
Yeah, sounds like it.
That's what usually happens with me. Mm-hmm. I'm actually so glad I actually had money this time, because last Steam sale I didn't have any money and I was very sad.
That is always sad.
One game. And this time I bought heaps, and then like my husband afterwards is like, oh, I need to get groceries. How much money do you have? $20.
Top ramen it is.
Yep, yep. No, I just pulled stuff out of the freezer. It's all good. It's all good. And yeah, Tomb Raider, awesome, but bogged down with the mechanics that was in the first, you know, too much collecting crap and upgrading and progression mechanics. You just want to raid tombs and, like, kill bad guys.
Stupid. Yes. Exploration at its simplest.
Quick time events. Like, the most annoying one, like, it's just, it's pointless that it's even there now. Like, if you jump, but, like, jump a little too far back, you have to do that little quick time event to, like, grab on properly. It happens every time, and it's freaking annoying. Like, I already know to basically double tap E when I hit the edge of something, just in case it pops up. Like, it's a non-mechanic now. It doesn't need to be there, but
right.
Of course you have to do it. And yeah, some of the jumping stuff feels a little off too. Like, it doesn't feel as polished as, like, Uncharted. Like, especially that new Uncharted. Like, he just moved so fluidly across walls, up everything and all that kind of stuff, whereas Tomb Raider feels a little bit still janky in that department.
And Naughty Dog just, they make crazy games that are awesome.
Yeah. But I also played 80 Days, which is like a story game traveling around the world, and you're with like this English gentleman and planning his trip and meeting different people and stories and all that kind of stuff. And this whole mechanic around, you know, selling items to get more money to buy better trips and that kind of thing. And I'm doing a Let's Play of it with really bad accents. So yeah, it's actually a really good game, and I recommend 80 Days. Like, I'm not even a story person, yet I really enjoy it because there's a whole heap of like choice added to it. Like, what decision in this conversation are you going to make? You know, what's your answer going to be, or what are you going to ask? And all that has like follow back in what the actual result in that encounter is.
That's so cool.
It's pretty good. And I played a mech-y kind of game called Brigador, which is kind of average. I feel kind of sad for it though, because there's been a few like game sites talking about it now and just how little they actually sold of this game, and the guy making it was like making it for like 7 years, so he's basically put 7 years into this game for nothing.
Yeah, that kind of sucks.
It does, and it's okay, but it's just, I don't know, it fails in the areas you really want, like progression, and just the movement feels a bit cumbersome and that kind of thing. So
that's a bummer, especially for an indie guy by himself.
It happens, though, but yeah, it's always sad to see. I'm sure it happens every single day with how many games are actually on Steam.
True.
But, yeah, and that's it. What have you been playing?
Well, like you, I spent a lot of money on the Steam Summer Sale, but I don't think I spent quite as much as you did. But first and foremost, I beat Doom the other night. Actually, it was at the beginning of last weekend. I had been playing through that for a little while. I finally put my mind to it, finished it off. Excellent game. Awesome from start to finish. Multiplayer's kind of meh, but I think it's worth the asking price for the story alone.
Oh, it's been on sale at the moment at some brick-and-mortar shops near me, like, for $35, and I've been thinking about
it. Get it. It's totally worth it. I paid, I think, $45, but it took me 10 hours to beat it. It's not, like, a really long game. You can play a couple hours here, a couple hours there, you'll beat it, no problem. It's and it's fun. As a result, I went and bought Wolfenstein The New Order, because Bethesda published that one as well, so I assume it's probably going to be kind of on a similar level. And I do remember reading good things about it in the past, but I was always more into Doom than Wolfenstein, so I got Doom with like no questions asked. Wolfenstein, it took me playing this Doom to see, okay, they can actually successfully remake something and make it better or make it good or whatever. So I haven't played that yet, though. I did I got a laundry list of games, two Pillars of Eternity. I bought a Pac-Man game. This other game called Crashlands, another one called Halcyon 6, Starbase Commander, something to that effect. I did buy Dragon Age Inquisition off Origin because it was on sale for the Game of the Year edition, and that's one that's been on my list for a long time to pick up. There's a few others in there that I'm not remembering, plus I'm still a member of Humble Monthly, and they gave us Satellite Rain this month, which I remember you said was really good.
So I'm looking forward to trying that out. Awesome. I really enjoyed that one.
So that's one. The Red Solstice, which looked kind of interesting, kind of a top-down strategy shooter type game too. The other ones are escaping me at the moment. But what I've actually been playing this week, despite buying all those games, a lot of them are just sitting in the backlog, or they're games that I need to beat something else before I can really put my focus on it. So after beating Doom, I started Dragon Age Inquisition because that one's been on my most wanted list for a long time. So got started with that. I've played for a couple hours. I'm enjoying it so far. It is similar to the other Dragon Age games, but does feel a little more MMO-ish, if that makes sense. Like the hotbars and the way things are set up, it just feels more in-depth than, I guess, older Dragon Age games. But then the skill systems are pretty much the same. Crafting seems pretty similar, although now it seems like you can do some upgrades to your weapons and armor, which you couldn't do before. So they've added some little tweaks and whatnot, but I haven't got far enough into it to really know what's different. But so far, it's been pretty fun. The combat is a little wonky, only because I played the first two Dragon Age games on the PlayStation. So switching over to mouse and keyboard feels a little weird, because it's like your basic attacks, you click, but then all of your other abilities are like hotkeyed, and you move with WASD. So it just, like, in the camera controls, you need to like hold right click and spin around and stuff. So it's a little weird, but the more I play, the more I get used to it, and that's been pretty cool. Then I did, like I said, I bought a Pac-Man game. It's called Pac-Man 256, and it's, I guess, based off of a glitch that was on the original arcade cabinets. And it's a completely different mode. It's basically like an endless level, and you just keep going as long as you can. But there's like glitchy stuff at the bottom of the screen that keeps coming up, and if you get caught in it, you die. If you get caught by a ghost, you die, yada yada. So you just try to go through as far as you can, last as long as you can, get the highest score you can, and go until you die. So it's almost like roguelike Pac-Man in a way. It's kind of cool, and it was only like $5 or something like that, so definitely worth it if you like Pac-Man type games, and it's a variant, so it's not the same exact thing that you're used to doing. There's little power-ups and stuff that are add to it too as well. And then Crashlands is a game that's, I would say, very similar to like Don't Starve, which Don't Starve is a game that I played a little bit of but didn't really get into it, but I know that you played it more than I did.
Yeah, I played it a heap.
It seems like it's a similar type of game, except for a little bit of a sci-fi angle to it, because you're a guy on a ship, and then you're in warp speed. You get pulled out of warp speed by some alien at some weird alien planet. The alien steals something out of your ship, causes your ship to crash land, and then from there you're supposed to just like survive. So you go gather stuff and find recipes, learn to build new things. You're supposed to be trying to build some sort of communication thing so that you can actually communicate with whoever your, you know, home base is, so that they can send you out a tow truck, per se, to help get your ship back off the ground. So I guess that's the end goal. But in the process, you know, you have to like start off with little crappy wood armor and like wooden swords, and you upgrade from there and upgrade from there. And so it's kind of got that Terraria feel as well, where it's a lot of exploring and, you know, less digging, of course. But it's pretty cool so far. I've enjoyed it. And the only other game that I really played much this past week was Halcyon 6, which is a game that's in early access. I've been watching it for a little while. It's kind of got a mixture of genres going for it, but because it's in early access, there's only like one act currently available for you to play through. And then I guess there's a couple more acts that are in progress. So it's basically like it's kind of a strategy game, like 4X kind of, but then also has elements of like turn-based, like JRPG combat almost, where like your ships have different abilities and stuff, and you fight each other, maybe kind of like Faster Than Light 2 in a sense. But then during those combat times, like your ships are fighting their ships until whoever wins, and then it goes back to where you're like on the bridge of your star or space station, and you have to do different, you know, missions, upgrade things. It's kind of got the XCOM screen where you can open up different areas inside of the ship and then build new buildings that allow you to build different things and stuff. But there's a lot of depth there, but I haven't gotten deep enough into it to really explain it thoroughly. But it looks kind of like, you know, like I said, a 4X strategy type game that's very sci-fi and Star Trek-like. So I've enjoyed it. It's also got sort of a pixel art style that I enjoy. So it's pretty cool. Check it out if you're interested in that sort of thing. But yeah, that's it for me. I have lots of other games that I'll probably be talking about sooner or later that I picked up recently in sales. But for now, that's all I've played. All right, so for the discussion this episode, we wanted to do something different and special because our two-year anniversary just rolled by. I think it was like June 25th, 26th, somewhere in there. I don't remember the exact date, but I do know it was towards the tail end of June. So having been in the podcast game for a couple years, we've racked up 91 episodes prior to this one. And I was thinking that if we went over them, we might find some differences of opinion. Where, you know, because as most normal people, as you get older, time goes by, you grow, you change, your opinions change, things around you change, influence you, yada, yada, yada. So I already know that there's a couple episodes where I may have made some statements and now would totally go back on those or have a totally different opinion. So
I can't really that's what I'm hoping to get at. Said. Like, once an episode's done, like, it is just erased from my mind entirely. I guess you keep editing and stuff, so it must be easier.
Perhaps that helps. I mean, I can't remember every single little tidbit of every single episode, and that's not the point. What I really want to do is just go over an episode, talk about, you know, who was the guest, what we were talking about, you know, whatever it was that was the hot button issue at the time. There's some trends that, you know, you'll see throughout where we changed our format or had, you know, regular guests that came back over and over, and then just changes of opinion on a particular topic that was on a one episode. A good example is like the esports thing. I made some commentary there about my opinion of esports at the time, and my opinion of esports now is probably different. So with that said, that's basically our general aim here, to just run through these. We'll spend a few minutes on each episode, but it's still likely to be rather long, so if it does run long, we'll probably split it into two shows.
We should call this the, like, Izzy is always wrong episode.
I mean, we could, but that doesn't necessarily have to be true. So, episode one, way back in June of 2014. It actually says here on my blog that it was published on June 20th. So it's actually been a couple weeks over 2 years. But either way, so our inaugural episode came out in June 2014. So it's been a couple years. Lots of things have changed, I'm sure. First episode, we basically were just getting a feel for what we were trying to do. Do you remember, like, how we had done a couple episodes prior to that where we had recorded? I know that there was a thing around E3 time, which, coincidentally, we just talked about E3 not that long ago on this show.
I barely remember what I had for breakfast, but yeah, keep going. That's all right.
Well, I remember that we had a couple episodes prior to it, just trying to practice, find our voices, figure out, you know, get past the nerves of recording and all of that good stuff. So we had done an episode that we didn't ever release that was us gushing over whatever was announced at E3 in 2014. But then because we weren't, you know, we didn't feel that it was really ready, we ended up coming up with this format, doing this particular show this particular way, and that kind of ended up being the format for a while. And basically it was what we do now, where we start off with a little intro, we talk about what we've been playing, but then we used to have a topic that was short and usually only, you know, 10-15 minutes. Then we would talk about idiots on the internet, and then we usually would do some sort of community spotlight. That ended up being our format for quite some time. In the first episode, we basically just ended up talking about the NBI that had just wrapped up the month prior. So, you know, this all probably sounds familiar considering the NBI just wrapped up again and E3 just happened, etc. I don't think there's really much else to cover on that particular episode just because it was kind of not generic, but it was, you know, us finding our bearings. But in episode 2, that one was entitled Player Rights, and we jumped into the first ever digital frontier with Dune. And the reason behind that was because initially when I was thinking about doing a podcast, I had approached both Dune and Aerie about potentially being co-hosts, and Dune had said that he would never be able to adhere to a weekly schedule, which we have found out to be very true. But he decided that he would come and be on our show once a month. So with the first episode of the Digital Frontier, we talked about player rights and basically what we thought our rights were as players of games.
You have a right to remain silent. It's basically it.
I mean, there are lots of different rights. I think we were mainly talking about, you know, the rights of as, you know, with terms of service and other things like that. You know, the types of rights where that can affect you in the real world.
I don't think my decisions change much. Like, I still think our basic right with games is to be able to play them. Basically, indefinitely, they are our product. We've purchased them. You know what I mean? Like the whole like MMOs going, you know, dying, basically, you know, getting shut down. Like, I think we should still be able to play them if that is our want, you know, to open up a private server. If you're no longer providing that service, then someone else should be able to.
There was also, yeah, that's something that I would agree with as well. And there was also a community spotlight that we pulled up on this particular episode where we had been talking to Simcha. She had written a post about how voice chat had kind of excluded her from various gaming communities because a lot of people switched over from chatting via the in-game text messaging to using voice chat. And with her being a deaf person that games, she was worried about, you know, the ability to, you know, communicate with people in the future because if everybody went over to voice chat, you know, that kind of excludes her completely. So we talked about those types of rights too. We also sort of all agreed that it was a good thing to include those types of features, you know, something where, you know, people that don't have all of their hearing or don't have sight or, you know, whatever the case may be, could still be able to play a game. You know, colorblind filters and other things like that have been added in lots of games. But as far as like, you know, complete accessibility for everyone, not quite there yet, but it is something that seems to be on developers' minds. In episode 3, we talked about sales, which I think we could probably have a thing or two to say about that now, considering the Steam sale that had has just finished. And I think around the time that this episode was recorded, it was the same sort of time frame. We'd just gone through some Steam sales.
Steam sales kind of suck now, though. Like, no offense to them, but like they used to be great value for me and Oz, but lately they really haven't been going down in price that much, and it's actually cheaper for me often to just go down to the local like game store and pick them up, which used to be completely ridiculous thought, but now it's coming back again. Like, why is going down the store, buying physical media, cheaper than actually getting something on sale on one of these sites? Even like that's ridiculous. I don't know.
No, that is ridiculous. I agree with you. But that has to do with international pricing. I don't know how that gets fixed per se, unless they give you like the Australian version of Steam, and so it works off your own economy and works out better, I guess. But here in the US, Steam sales are great. I still think they're great, but they have the issue of, like you said, where you went and spent $200 on a single group of games. I probably spent at least $100. So I mean, having those huge discounts, or even not so huge discounts, are still enough of those things. It's enough of an incentive to kind of push you into maybe buying more games than you need or more games than you could possibly play. I'm at the point where I'm starting to wonder if I'll be able to ever finish all of the games that I own before I die. And that's like a hell of a backlog.
Yeah, I looked at my like Steam backlog recently. You know that site where it tells you how long you have to actually like play through your stuff?
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, that's bad. Don't look at mine.
Yeah, I've looked at mine before, and usually I have a pretty small percentage of games that I haven't played, because typically even if I buy a game with the intention on not necessarily completing it right away, like, for instance, I bought Pillars of Eternity this Steam sale, and it's a game that I've wanted for a long time, and I just didn't want to miss the sales price, because the sale price was like $17, full price is like $45. So, yeah, I mean, $45 isn't that much money to begin with, but it's still, you know, it's an older game. It's always full price, except for once in a while on a Steam sale. So I was like, this Steam sale, I'm going to get it with no intentions of playing it. But there have been plenty of times where I have done something like that and still fired the game up at least and played it. So my unplayed percentage isn't that bad. But my complete percentage, yeah. I mean, I just wrote a post on my blog today about how many games I've completed in 2016. Three. I'm a lot
better than that. Wow.
Well, I play a lot of League of Legends. I've played a lot of other games that don't have any sort of completion.
Yeah, and how much Black Desert Online was I playing? Go away.
Well, right. But I mean, out of all the games you completed, how many of them were AAA and how many of them were indies? Because indies tend to be 10 hours or less, whereas a AAA usually is, especially if you're talking RPGs, can be hundreds of hours.
Well, a lot of the games I play are like open-ended builders, though, which is kind of hard.
Right. Well, and that's where I have the MOBAs and shooters.
Like, when the
and
hell
stuff.
Would you have finished Stardew Valley? Like, how many hundreds of like potatoes harvested?
Yeah, that's a game that doesn't have an end. Any of those survival type games don't have ends. MOBAs, shooters, anything that's competitive, none of that stuff has an end and can be a huge time sink. And that's where I've spent the majority of my time that could have been spent clearing the backlog. But that's why I haven't played League in like a month. So there.
I've actually been clearing my backlog as well recently, which is weird.
That's what I'm trying to do. It's hard. It's hard because you get onto these sales and it's like, okay, well, I'm going to buy all of these games that I had on my wish list. And then Humble Monthly, they added in all kinds of games that I had thought about buying at some point or another, but never did. So, yeah. And then it's like, you want to play them all? There's not enough time. And I think that those sales kind of definitely influence our behavior. And that's something that we talked about in the original episode. And I think that still holds true. It definitely pushes us in directions that we might not necessarily go. Because I know that there's times during the year where I'm like, I have tons of games. I don't need to pay for any new ones. I don't need a new one. And then Steam sale. Oh, you know, I don't really need these, but why not? Let's get them. Moving on. This one is one that I know I have contention with my old opinion. In episode 4, we talked about esports. I think we had Murph on this particular episode as well, but we talked about MOBAs in general because those seem to be the front runner as far as bringing it to more mainstream appeal. But there have been fighting game tournaments for like Street Fighter, Mortal Kombat, Smash Brothers. There's been Hearthstone tournaments. Yada, yada, yada. I mean, every MOBA out there pretty much is an esport. Now, games like Overwatch have come out to become an esport. Even TF2 is now announcing that they're going to have a competitive
Overwatch will actually make itself an esport.
It was built to be one.
No, I mean, like, officially. You know what I mean? Lots of games are built to be an esport, but not many actually do make it. Like, friggin' Guild Wars 2, they wanted their game to be an esport. Tug a little harder, but
they
wanted to. Yeah, exactly. But, I mean, some people have the intention of it. It doesn't mean it's going to happen.
Right. So, at the time, I remember one of the biggest argument that we had over there is because I'm a sports fan, I watch professional football, we had a debate on whether or not MOBAs and games, video games that are being played as sports should be considered a sport for real. We kind of talked about the nuance of the whole esports thing. Why is it called esports? Does that necessarily the best title for it? But I remember arguing pretty heavily against them being considered a sport, and now I've completely changed my mind.
You didn't just argue against it; you were like adamant they aren't sports.
Yeah,
like you were like the dude bro analogy of sports. It has to be physical, physical, physical.
Well, you know, and to a degree, I still feel that way, but I am accepting of esports as a sport. But I look at it in a different sort of way. And what by that I mean, like, I realize that those guys play 8 hours a day. They're practicing the way professionals practice. They're competing in tournaments the way competitors compete in tournaments. So, I mean, all of the cross references there, like, it makes sense. It's a sport. It's done exactly the same way. They have coaches. They have organizations. Every part of it is a sport. At the time, though,
In 10 years' time, esports are going to be massive. Like,
oh, yeah.
Bigger than they are now and more of a global thing as well. I think we'll even see them in the Olympics eventually in about 10 years' time.
I wouldn't doubt it.
Or 12 years. Or maybe 8 years. But yeah, it's just one of those things that's going to get bigger the more technological our society gets. Yeah.
Well, and proof positive that it has gotten bigger is like just here at this recent E3, EA got on there and was talking about how Madden is now going to be an esports tournament. And there'll be money awarded to people for playing Madden. So not only are there millionaires who play football for real, there will be millionaires who also play football, but from a couch. And yeah. It is kind of funny when you think about it that way. And I could see where, you know, some people that are still on the other side of the fence, I could see where they'd be offended. They'd be offended by that. But at the end of the day, I mean, the preparation I've seen go into it, it's the same.
Those big league tournaments pulled in many millions more like viewers than the Super Bowl.
That's true, but they're also counting all of China and all of
Super Bowl ones. A lot of people watch Super Bowl. They count all the online watches and they count all the people that have subscribed to those channels exactly for the Super Bowl. They know how many are watching it.
Well, I know it's gotten bigger in like Europe, but as far as like Asian countries, I don't think so much. And Asian countries are like all over esports, so there's going to be huge amounts. But I get your point. I mean, it's from an online perspective, it's huge. It's only just cracking into like ESPN and stuff, but supposedly like ESPN2 is supposed to host either like the Dota Championships or some other big time thing. So it's creeping into the mainstream more and more every day. And 2 years ago when we talked about this, I don't think it was quite there yet. And that's why I was so on the fence about it and not able to admit the things that I'm admitting now. But having watched them for 2 extra years and seen it just grow and grow, it's definitely a new phenomenon. And it's definitely sports-like.
It's funny with like young kids now, like, you know how everyone used to be a movie star, a rock star, all that kind of stuff. Now it's I want to be like a Twitch superstar or, you know, like esports star.
YouTuber or, yeah.
YouTuber, you know, all that kind of stuff. So it's just a switch towards this kind of thing.
And it was crazy, too, because like if you watch some of the Korean streams, man, and even some of the little like blooper videos and other little videos that they'll put together, and those guys are treated like celebrities. It's ridiculous. They're treated the way our pro sports stars are treated here in America. It's the same level of like celebrity. There's a guy named Faker at League of Legends. He's like known as essentially the best player in the world. And like that dude's worshipped. And he's like a 20-year-old kid. It's crazy. But it's cool too, because it's something that, you know, not everyone can do, just like sports. So it has all of the same parallels.
People will aspire to, yeah. Cool.
It is. So then episode 5, we talked about diversity, and this is a topic that we've come across, I don't know, 2 or 3 times. I know more recently, like within the last few episodes, we actually did a recap on this, and this was another sort of, I don't think this was one of Dune's actually. No, this was not Dune's. This was us talking about diversity on our own. See, Dune, we don't need you for in-depth topics. We can do it on our own.
Dune definitely helps.
He does. So basically we were just talking about diversity in media, not just games. We talked about comics, other things, and I know that this is the infamous Beaverine episode. For those of you that don't remember or were not listening at that time, we ended up talking about gender swapping comic book heroes, and we came up with a few different gender swapped names, and Wolverine turned into Beaverine.
Well, I said like I'd really like a female Wolverine, and then you guys were making up stupid names, and then I was like, it'd be Beaverine, and I cacked myself laughing.
Yes. So, I mean, basically in this episode, and we'll end up touching on this a couple more times as we run through this list, the majority of the topic at hand was just how are things, you know, going diversity wise in gaming and other bits of media. And, you know, considering a couple years later, we ended up talking about it again. It did seem like, I don't know, what do you think? Do you think since 2014 there's been an improvement?
I honestly don't think so. I think it's actually gotten worse. Like, this episode was actually before the Gamergate stuff, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And since then, we've actually had a few diversity. Like, we actually had a whole is it any better now sort of diversity thing. And I don't know, it feels like it's getting progressively worse at this stage. Like, those battle lines are getting more and more drawn, you know what I mean, between different people and groups and that kind of stuff. Like, constant attacks on people. It's just, it's ridiculous.
Yeah, I think I see where you're going with that, but then at the same time, I think that it is better than it was 2 years ago.
From an industry perspective, definitely yes. A lot better. Like, we're getting a lot more games with different types of protagonists. Like, it's definitely not, like, where it should be yet, in my mind, but I think it is getting better.
So, I would agree with that.
Well, it's funny, like, looking at the recent E3, it's weird, but it was actually worse for representation than last year's in terms of having a female protagonist available, not just in their own game, but just, like, as an option. It was actually worse in terms of the amount of characters.
Yeah.
There's still a huge lack of, like, different racial options in games, like, just racial protagonists, you know what I mean? It's always either a white guy, and if that's not available, oh, here's your, you know, white female, you know? There's really very little else there. And yes, in games where you get to choose your character and create a character, sure, they're going to give you that option, but you don't see, you know, like, protagonist-led games that just are more diverse.
Yeah, I mean, I'll agree with you. It's not where it needs to be, but I do think it has gotten at least a little better in certain aspects.
The problem with gaming is it takes so long for many of these games to actually get developed and put out, you know what I mean? So we're starting to see the headway now because this was an issue a few years ago and then they've started working to it. So the more years that go on, the more we'll see those sort of changes actually take effect, you know, actually become games.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, I think we still have to wait a little bit before that kind of happens more and we see more and more.
So what, 5 more years? It might be a little bit better?
It's hard to because we still need to see, like, properly successful female-led games, African-American-led games, you know, Asian protagonist-led games, that kind of stuff. Like, I know the new Watch Dogs? Is it Watch Dogs? Has African-American?
I don't know, but Shadow Warriors is an Asian protagonist.
Yeah, Shadow Warriors and the new Horizon Zero Dawn, a female-led protagonist. We need to see these games doing well financially before I think a lot of these big companies will actually take it up even more, you know what I mean?
Aside from the big companies like BioWare that have already been pushing those types of envelopes, at least a little.
No, but BioWare, it's always a choice, you know what I mean? It's not just, oh, here's your female character that you can only play as. It's like, here's your character, create them how you want.
Well, right, kind of that thing. Part of it, but they've built a lot of other diverse characters in their
games, yeah, that you can meet and love and all that kind of
interact
stuff. Interact with, yeah. They're definitely pushing the envelope there. But I think as we see these games being more and more successful, companies will take notice and go, well, I guess we don't need to just have random white guy 23 in our games anymore.
Yes. So speaking of the battle of the sexes, in episode 6, we went back to Dune's Digital Frontier and talked about what he called successful sexism, which sounded horrible to us until he really explained it. But what his definition was, it meant that the author acknowledges the content created has sexist content, but is using it to create a discussion in a positive light.
I think he was more talking about Mountain Blade and the mechanics.
There was that.
Female ruler.
Yeah, the ability to create a female character, and it was essentially like a harder mode in the game. And that was sexism, you know, an example of sexism, but then it was a positive thing because it kind of brought about conversation about the fact that, you know, things between men and women aren't equal. And then I do remember, like I said, jumping into the whole Game of Thrones thing, where we had talked about, you know, some of the positive female role models, that not necessarily in just that particular show, but some of the stronger female characters and some of the ways that it is still sexist, but it at least brings those topics to the foreground where people will discuss them.
I do agree with him a little bit more now that games can do positive sexism, if that makes sense, successful sexism. Like Prison Architect and their new mode when 1.1 came where you could have a female prison. And there was very slight gameplay changes, like female prisoners being a little bit weaker, having a few other needs, like motherly needs, that kind of stuff. And it changed up the dynamic quite a bit. But it didn't feel like some kind of crammed in mechanic like we usually see. It didn't feel like some kind of negative sexism, like denigrating women in prisons, that kind of stuff. It was more just a way to, you know, critique and think about these different things in the world, you know? Think about actual sexism, think about women in prison, that kind of stuff. So, it was more of a way to make people think about that. And that's successful sexism, I think.
I can't think of any other recent examples there as far as that goes.
I think we're still seeing a lot of negative stuff, though.
Yeah.
Like unsuccessful sexism.
Yeah, like the other night I was watching the new Jim Jefferies special. He's a guy that's from Australia, comedian. I've watched quite a few of his specials. I think he's hilarious. But, yeah, like within the first like 5 minutes of his special, it was like just misogyny. But then he explains himself and just goes, okay, you know, look, I'm a comedian. These are jokes, blah, blah, blah. But, yeah, I could see where that's just perpetuating the problem. Like, granted, I'm still going to watch that kind of thing. I'm still going to laugh at it. I'm still going to enjoy the sense of humor. But the more famous people that are making those types of jokes just perpetuates the problem, I suppose you could say.
Yeah. Well, I'm kind of acutely aware of that kind of stuff now. Like, in Australia, there's actually this big advertisement campaign against domestic abuse, all that kind of stuff, you know, sexism and all that kind of thing, and just how the simple ways it perpetuates. Like, yeah, it actually starts off with this child, and dad's, like, just doing innocuous comments, like, son's throwing, it's like, oh, don't throw like a girl, kind of stuff, while the girl's standing there. And then you've got another instance where he knocks over a girl, and mum's just, oh, yeah, don't worry about that, it's because he likes you, kind of stuff. And it's all those, and then later on you see him grow up and, like, start bashing women, you know what I mean? And then it comes right to him, and you see, they're talking about, it's these simple ways that we breed sexism. So I think there are still a lot of negative things like that are perpetuating the culture.
And yeah, so much of that is like ingrained in you, and then you pass it on to the next generation just because it's the same way you grew up. All right, so for the next one, again, with this list, in an effort to be able to split this into a couple episodes, it's definitely going to take some time, but I'm going to just kind of run through some of these really quick just to get to the ones where we really have more to talk about. So in episode number 8, we talked about nostalgia, and that came up from a post that I had written talking about nostalgia itself. It was a quote I saw somewhere. Don't remember the exact quote off the top of my head, but we had talked about, you know, how nostalgia can be a good thing, but then also a bad thing, where, let's say, a good game that you remember playing back in the day, like, let's say, good example is like the new Doom that just came out. So this Doom definitely pulls on those nostalgia strings because it reminds you of the old Dooms. It's very similar mechanically, but then they've added the new school, you know, looks, polish, shine, whatever you want to call it. You know, obviously it looks 10 times better than the original Doom, but still holds kind of the same tenets, has similar map design, similar combats, same sort of weapons. It just looks pretty. It's modernized and it's a lot of fun. That's an example of good nostalgia. Now, bad nostalgia could be something where it's like some game that you played, you know, when you were a teenager, you absolutely love, thought it was the greatest game ever. You look back with, you know, the rose-colored lenses and end up thinking, you know, that game was awesome. It could never be a bad thing. Go back and play it and then realize, wow, like, take like Final Fantasy VII. If I went back and played that now, it looks horrible. I don't want to play it at all. But my nostalgia for it still says it's a great game.
My nostalgia's for Rift a little bit, like the MMO.
Yeah.
Loved it when I first got into it, and then when I got back into it, terrible. God, it has aged badly.
Well, and that's like I said, with Doom, it was like a good nostalgia, and then with some other games like Final Fantasy VII, it's a bad nostalgia. Like, looking back on it, it sounds great, but could not play it again. That's why that remake coming should be kind of fun.
Wolfenstein was a pretty good one as well. I know you were talking about Doom, but like Wolfenstein, another same sort of thing. It's like it's taking its old ideals, but then bringing
giving it,
it
the new polish
into the modern age. You know, certain modern mechanics, but still giving that gameplay feel of the old games. That's where you got to be.
So any of these episodes that I skip over, you know, they are all in the archive. You can go check them out. If there's something that, you know, we pass by that you want to hear more about, just go find the episode and have a listen.
Or just tell us what you'd want to hear more of, and we can probably do another episode on it.
That
some of those
too.
Old things that would be pretty cool to talk about again.
Yes. That's why I just wanted to do a little recap. We can get into more detail at some other point in time if need be. So episode 10 was called Attack of the Clones, and Dune came back to join us for another episode. And in this particular one, we were talking about the mobile game market and how some games will come out and essentially within hours, minutes, days, whatever, very quickly, a bunch of different, you know, independent people, programmers, whoever they are, would just go and take that existing concept, like say Flappy Bird or whatever other Angry Birds, you know, anything that was ridiculously popular, they go and take that same exact idea, copy it, and throw it out there on the marketplace for money, and actually take money away from those larger developers and people who made the original ideas, which I think is probably still running rampant. I don't know. I don't play a lot of mobile games. Have you played any mobile games recently, Ari?
None.
Yeah.
Pokemon.
So, oh, yeah, that one. Well, that is a developer copying itself, so that's not so bad, I suppose. But
I just mean you're going to see a ton of like Pokemon Go clones in like the weeks and months to come.
Oh, well, there'll just be a Digimon one or whatever.
Digimon would be okay, yeah. I'll go with Digimon.
Yeah, you're okay with that? Even though that's like the biggest ripoff ever?
Yep.
So, yeah, like I said, I assume that's something that's probably still going on, but neither of us really get into the mobile things, so I guess we'll move along. So, episode 13, we talked about gaming skill levels. Basically just talked about, you know, whether or not games inherently take skill, what kind of skills are necessary. And then some of the games that we thought, you know, we enjoyed more maybe because they took more skill. Like, I know we talked about, like, say, Diablo and playing hardcore mode. Like, that inherently takes more skill than non-hardcore because you actually have to worry about dying. And then, you know, MOBAs, shooters, anything else that's twitchy obviously takes a certain skill set. And I think we may have also talked about it in this episode. I know we've talked about it at some point, but there was a point I brought up about the older you get, essentially, you supposedly have lowered reaction times. But then you had said that you had read something somewhere that countered that and said that actually that's not true. Some people, yes, but for the majority, it's kind of pretty similar for most of your life.
Well, it's a lot less than what people think it is, especially those people that play games throughout their life. Like, you still maintain a lot of the synapses around that kind of movement and spatial control.
I do think that there have been times where I feel like I have decreased in skill.
I totally believe I'm wrong now because I'm getting worse. I totally am.
Yeah, it feels that way.
Like, I feel so much worse in this shooting game. I feel like terrible. I never remembered being this noob-like.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think my reaction speeds have slowed down too. But then I surprise myself sometimes because I've actually like recorded games of any game, anything that I've played competitively. I have recorded games and like been impressed with myself. Like, wow, I pulled that off. That was awesome. You know, so maybe it's just in our head.
The good stuff. You don't record when you're like completely shitting it up.
No, I've posted videos of me shitting it up. Thank you very much. I still think games take a particular set of skills. But I think that we probably do decrease in skill because, I mean, most people I know that are 40 plus aren't really playing twitchy games anymore. And I can see where eventually you might get frustrated enough because of your decline to not really want to keep pursuing that. Hence,
well,
RPGs and MMOs.
Kinds of games, though, you know what I mean? Like, it's not just like you'd go, oh, I'm not as good at this game now, therefore I quit games forever. That's just ridiculous. Like, even if you think about MOBAs, like, there's easier MOBAs. Like, if you're getting a little bit worse, go play HOTS, you know?
Yes, I got you to say something negative about a Blizzard game. Awesome.
I was always negative, not negative about that game, but I always said it was Baby's First MOBA. I admitted that. I admitted I was playing Baby's First MOBA and looking at it, so I really haven't said anything bad.
Well, that one's kind of faded into obscurity.
And what are you talking about? I bag on WoW all the time.
I know, but that's the one that everybody... That's easy. That's an easy target. That's everybody's punching bag.
Blizzard game, though.
Episode 15, we introduced Bragtoberfest, which was a short-lived one-time-only thing. A couple years ago, myself and Ari ended up running an event throughout October because we wanted to try and bridge the gap between events that our community was doing. Because there was the NBI, and then Belgast started the whole Bloggus thing in August. So we figured October was a good time because then, and then maybe kind of come up with something in the spring and kind of have like year-round.
We should try to do Bragtober again.
Yeah, we could. It's definitely, I mean, with enough planning, it's definitely something that could be done again. Last year, I don't think we really put any thought into it. And essentially all it was...
planning.
Yes, yes we are. Hence this
year's
NBI.
We're good at planning, but we're not good at the follow-through part.
It's because I'm usually in bed when you're awake and vice versa. But we do make it work most of the time. So basically this episode was just us introducing the whole concept, talking about what we wanted to do, and then... You know, we just followed through with that. That particular episode event, I should say, we just wanted people to have, you know, some writing prompts, but it was basically about getting together and having gaming with blogger friends so that you not only would have new people to play video games with, but then also you could write about the experience. And quite a few people did write about it when it was going on. So we had a few different gaming experiences throughout the month. I know I ran a couple. I think you had Path of Exile or something. I played a couple other games. I don't really remember what they were at this point in time, but it was a good time. The people who joined in seemed to enjoy themselves, and maybe it's something that we'll do again. In episode 16, we got back on the whole sexism stuff, but this time we turned it back towards guys. And took a look at the male body image. And, you know, most sexist or sexism discussions revolve around the negative connotations towards women. But then me and Dune were like, well, wait, you know, I know there's got to be some bits of that that are, you know, more directed towards men. And there was the whole discussion about, you know, how almost every single guy is a meathead, alpha male, huge rippling muscles, and most guys playing those games, yeah, it's like what did we call it before? It's like fetishizing it, power violence fantasy type thing. But, you know, so it's like what they think men want to aspire to be or want to look up to or whatever. But when in truth, like hardly any of us ever look like the characters in the video games that we play. I mean, with the exception of maybe like a Nathan Drake, who isn't really a meathead buff dude, you know, like he's more of an average Joe. But yeah,
he's a bit more of a meathead in the recent one.
Personality-wise is not what I mean. I mean more like, you know, just the
His body shape changed a little bit.
He's not ripped. He's not huge and buff and overly exaggerated.
Yeah, no, I agree with that.
And that's basically that I could get behind the whole, you know, Gears of War or God of War or any of those, you know, big hulking dudes. I'm like, I can't relate to those guys. Plus, most of them are all hoorah soldier types, and I don't really like that
now, though. Like, I watched the recent God of War trailer. Like, it's a couple weeks ago now. But my God, I don't care. I there was no caring in me at all. Like, even when I saw the Gears of War one, like, I've played and liked some of those games, but then I saw this one, I was like, I really just don't give a shit. I'm so over these meatheads.
Well, right, and that wasn't. The point per se. The point was just like how that can negatively affect, you know, young boys growing up and thinking,
body image, definitely.
Right.
Well, I think it ties into the overarching sexism as well, like trying to teach boys to have to be this giant, powerful alpha male kind of person. You know what I mean? It feeds into that same kind of sexism.
Yeah. No, I agree.
And it's all bad. Like, it's not good. Like, yeah, like, of course we want some characters like that, and I do enjoy some characters like that myself. Like, it's not something we have to get rid of entirely, but just think about why we're creating this sort of character. Is it right for that person? What are the consequences of creating a character like that? You know, what are the consequences of creating thousands of characters like that? So, yeah.
So, I mean, it's something obviously that hasn't changed much in a couple years, but was still something that it needed to be said, you know, just because it always ends up being usually the opposite focus. We just wanted to bring some light to the other side of the discussion, and we moved on from there. Episode 19. This was a fun one. This was our first time really discussing PvP, and we got a little bit heated because of the fact that I think it was Sip from BioBreak. He ended up making a post about Arcage of all games, which I never even really ended up playing. You did, but there was that whole argument about whether or not there should be PvE servers in a game that was designed to be PvP from the ground up. And we had a good old argument back and forth over whether or not that was a good idea. Obviously, we being PvP fans were more against it than for it, but didn't there end up being PvE servers at the end of it?
No.
No? See, no, because it was locked behind
levels.
There was
this whole, like issue that was blown out of proportion. Like, the PvP in Arcage really wasn't that bad. Like, people were just being friggin' sooks. Honestly, like you can do everything in that game without ever touching PvP. It's not an issue. Like, yeah, some of those zones do go into PvP, but that's only for like half an hour or 40 minutes. And then they go back to normal for a couple hours, you know, where you can't be touched.
Yeah, and maybe that's not the best example either.
The whole, like, trading mechanic, it just wouldn't have worked if it was actually PvE, because there'd be no risk, you know?
Right.
The risk was where what made it more meaningful and what made it more... like profitable. Like, you'd have to completely rework that mechanic if there was no risk there, no risk of losing any items.
Right.
Like, you could do the longest, best profitable route ever, all the time, every time. Like, that's not how the game was balanced.
Yeah. And I think right around the same time, there were several other people that blogged. We linked quite a few different posts that people had been, you know, milling over it, the same discussion, but it ended up being pretty heated in the blogosphere there for a little while, between people, you know, kind of being pro PvP and those that were not. And there are, it seems like, a larger majority of people that are against PvP, hence lots of games not coming with PvP or having it tacked on, added on, and not in a good way.
I still don't think it's a good idea. I'm still against it.
What, PvE servers on PvP games?
Yeah, if a game is designed around PvP, I'm still thoroughly against it, because that's how the game's designed. Like,
exactly.
I wouldn't ask a PvE game to start, like, balancing completely for PvP.
Well, but that's what ends up happening on theme parks most of the time. They just throw a little arena there, and it's
stupid. I've argued against doing that, because it is stupid. It ruins games. It ruins the feeling. Like, I would rather if, like, say... what's a game I really like? Like, say, Rift, when I was playing, I would rather it didn't even have PvP sometimes, because it ruined some of the mechanics around the dungeons and stuff with the skills, and made certain, like, classes completely useless at times, because they were good in PvP, but they were shit in PvE, and you couldn't balance them properly, you couldn't buff them properly. Like, all that stuff happens. It's just the intentions of a game, and plus there's still a huge amount of, like, PvE games out there, if that's your thing. Like, there's no reason to turn every game into a PvE game. Just as there's no reason to turn every PvE game into a PvP game.
Yes, I agree with that.
Like, I get with the sandbox market, like, some people just want, like, a sandbox PvE game, you know? Like, in every, like, sandbox that comes out looks like it has PvP. But then I don't think those people are looking hard enough. Like, there is decent PvE sandbox out there.
Well, yeah, Minecraft is a great example. It's not an MMO,
be. Well, you can do servers, and it's basically, like, you know, multiplayer. But then you've got games like Worm, which people don't even look at. Worm Online, great PvE sandbox. And then you've got the games like Ark that came out. You can run PvE sandboxes and servers in that game. Like, there's a heap of options out there if that's
most
what
of those survival games are actually pretty PvE focused, and the PvP is just kind of additional if you feel like it.
But yeah, there's heaps of options. I just don't think people were looking hard enough for them, and just wanting everything to revolve around them.
We get into that a little bit more in a little bit. Let's move on. So episode 20, we kept with the whole MMO mechanics type discussion, and talked about eliminating levels, and we came up with several different ways that could theoretically work. You know, as far as either doing something where it's more like Ultima Online, where it's a skill based, and your skills, you know, if your skill is better at one thing than the next guy, then you win, or, you know, things like that. There was a lot of different alternate progression schemes that we came up with. I still think that that's a potentially a good idea, you know, going forward in MMO design, of maybe figuring out a way to get rid of levels as the primary, like, gating mechanic.
Definitely. Well, it's really funny, like, the more that time that's gone on, the more acceptable and the more we see, like, MMOs bringing out those, you know, level cap boosts. Purchase this, get to level 50. Right. Which is basically the game telling, like, them telling you that these levels are pointless and dumb. Like,
get to the end, play with your friends, skip all the boring shit.
Yeah, exactly.
But what's the point in having that?
Why creating the boring shit in the first place if that's what you're going to do?
Well, one thing that happened recently is with ESO, where they did the whole eliminating the level kind of restrictions on every zone.
I think it's a really cool thing. Yeah, like, I'm hearing a lot of people a bit humming and hawing about it, like invalidating their progression and that kind of stuff. You know, people wanting to feel powerful that they're making progress. But then you look at the normal leveling system and it's the same deal anyway. Yeah, you're getting more strength, you're getting better armor, but then the stuff you're fighting is a couple of levels higher anyway, so it's the same deal, you know? The power curve is still going up in the same way, whereas not having these levels, it opens the game up so much more. You can adventure where you want, do the quest you want, and it removes all those restrictions to actually playing with people.
Well, that was a thing really that was kind of a trademark of the Elder Scrolls games too, is that the content kind of always scaled with you. You could go wherever you wanted and you would find a challenge. And not everything, of course, eventually when you're higher level, like little dogs and wolves and shit don't really pose a threat anymore. But anytime you run into a dragon, it's still going to be a battle. So, yeah. I think that was kind
all
of a good
giant
good
trolls.
Right. All those things end up becoming they're still challenging, and it does seem like they would scale with you. If they don't necessarily scale with you automatically, there was still, you know, when you were on a quest, everything would be appropriate. And that was kind of a good idea. And I think that that could be, you know, the sort of type of them doing that as an experiment, you know, it could end up leading towards other developers doing the same sort of thing.
I really want to see it more often. I want to see more developers taking that on. Like, I think Black Desert Online, a game I did enjoy playing, but that game would have been so much better without levels. Like, just, yeah, like grinding up crafting materials or grinding up, you know, whatever other progression means you have. Like, some areas are harder than others, all that kind of stuff. It would have been a so much better game, but instead they had, like, you know, the whole 1 to 50 progression treadmill. Like, that's ridiculous.
Yeah, and it's a system that's been in use for so long that it seems to be hard for people to get away from. But I think that eventually it could happen. In episode 23, we talked about the cultural differences between Eastern and Western games, which I'm sure you probably have even more insights into now, considering you spent lots of time with Arc Age and then ended up spending lots of time with Black Desert. And
no, still the same.
Yeah. Still think Western games are better?
I never said that in the episode. I never said that. I just said that Eastern games seem to be pushing the envelope more in terms of mechanics and gameplay elements, whereas Western MMOs were just retreading the same mechanics over and over and over again.
This is true.
Which is true.
But Eastern ones tend to be grindfests at the same time.
They definitely have the certain mechanics they want to keep pushing all the time, but you just see a lot more innovation, for lack of a better word, within the Eastern market, because it is such a hard market. You know, they're trying to do anything they can to stand out. So, yeah, I still think we're seeing, like, you look at Arc Age and you even look at Black Desert Online, like, those games are significantly different experiences than what WoW is, you know, what the Western MMO culture is. Like,
yeah, the only one that I played recently was Blade and Soul, and that was horrible. Like, they had some good ideas with the combo mechanics and the way that the combat flowed. I mean, there was some cool stuff there, but it ended up just being a jiggly boob simulator for the most part. Boob physics.
That's
for the win.
What I said it was going to be, and I was right. I told you all.
You know, it was free to play. I tried it for a couple days. That was about it. Not my cup of tea. I have not played an MMO since. Episode 28 was a fun episode. It's actually something because of, what was it? How many year anniversary was it for Back to the Future at that point?
30?
It was Back to the Future. Basically, the whole idea was we wanted to talk about various things that were supposed to be in the future according to those movies, and we compared it to what's actually out. And in some ways, they were right on, and in other ways, they were way off. Like, we do have hoverboards now, but they don't actually hover. They're on wheels, so I don't understand how they're a hoverboard, but your guess is...
No, there's actually hoverboards, but they're shit at the moment. They're using magnets, but you have to have the entire, like, surface they're riding on, like, magnetized as well. And they only float, like, an inch off the ground.
Well, and then there's those even crappier hoverboards that have wheels.
On the other side, though, we do have, like, you know, the HoloLens stuff. You know, the 3D, where the shark comes out and goes, nom, nom, nom. Yes. So we are getting, like, 3D stuff.
Right, and then the whole VR...
We're getting stuff better than what was in that, you know? Like,
yes.
You see that shark? It was basically a giant polygon, you know?
Right.
Cut yourself on the edges of that shark. Like, and now it's just, like, really smooth, beautiful things.
Right, right, right.
I don't think... Even back then, I don't think they would have thought how far technology would have come in terms of, like, graphics and...
No, they had no idea yet. They had no idea, because those movies came out in the 80s, and that was the whole thing, was that it was supposed to have taken place when they went into the future. It was supposed to be 2015. This took, when we recorded this episode, it was 2015, so yeah, it was a good little time. Oh, episode 30, that was fun. The H1Z1 controversy. We were talking about, because H1Z1 was getting ready to launch.
It's not a controversy, it's shit.
Well, no, bullshit, because I remember on this episode you were actually kind of hyped for it. We were both kind of looking forward to it as maybe a new good PvP sandbox.
What I actually said was it could be good if they don't release it as early access shit. If they actually come out to the market with a polished and complete zombie simulator, it'll do well. What'd they do? Released early access shit.
Well,
so no, I wasn't wrong.
I don't know. It ended up being pretty successful monetarily speaking. Like, they sold quite a bit. And since then, though, they've actually gone and split it into two separate games because they added on that battle royale and blah blah blah. We do end up talking about this again later on in the future, but yeah, it was interesting to talk about at the time. It was kind of a current event piece. And H1Z1, I don't think, is really on our radars anymore. I mean, I still own it, but I haven't played it in forever. I was waiting for it to come out of early access. In episode 34, crowdfunding. Which, I don't know, has your opinion on crowdfunding changed at all? Are you still backing Kickstarters, buying early access games?
Yep. See, I've always been rather careful with what I do kickstart. Like, you scrutinize the product, who's making it, all that kind of stuff. So I really haven't had that many, like, failures from Kickstarter. And most of them I've got a couple. Like, I think the repopulation is probably my biggest failure. But I wasn't really cranky at them for that, if that makes sense. Like, they tried making it.
Yeah. If that makes sense. They tried and failed.
And I got that survival game fragmented out of it so far that I haven't played. But yeah, like, most games I've kickstarted have actually been pretty good that have come out of it. So
I'm in the same way. I've been pretty selective with what I've done. I've only kickstarted one game. And then early access, I've bought quite a few. I actually have some games in my library right now that are still in early access. I've also had some that actually finished and became full on games and were pretty awesome. I've also bought games that were Kickstarters. I just didn't actually kickstart them. So I know that the whole crowdfunding thing, it works, but it does seem to be, according to recent news stories, at least in the gaming sphere of things, there's a lot less dollars going into it nowadays, because I think people are doing more, like what you said, in scrutinizing all of it before actually putting down some money.
I think that report was just stupidly bogus. Like, if you actually look at the trends and look at the kickstarting market, like, this year has actually been pretty sparse for, like, decent projects. You know what I mean? Like, I've been looking at it basically every month, seeing what there's a kickstart, and there's only been one or two games that have actually, like, piqued my interest, and only one that I actually kickstarted. Like, the years before, there was always games coming out like, oh, that looks awesome, that looks cool too, I want to kickstart that, you know what I mean? And then you also had those really big name Kickstarter projects, you know?
Yeah.
That brought out a lot of money, and big IPs wanting to kickstart as well, and this year, like, it's just been shit all in that regards. So that's why I think it's down, you know? Like, there just hasn't been the projects of that caliber this year.
Perhaps. I think people might be a little bit more wary about it, too, because of a lot of early access games that failed and a lot of Kickstarter games that never saw the light of day despite getting funding. So, moving on to episode 35, we talked about Crowfall, which is the only game I've ever Kickstarted, and niche MMOs in general. And I think, at least for me, my opinion has not changed. I still think niche MMOs are the wave of the future, as evidenced by the fact that all we've seen in the last, year or two has been basically either imports or nothing, really. I mean, what other AAA MMOs have come out? Like, none, basically? Well, like 2 years?
I think Black Desert was the biggest one.
Yeah, that's an import. So, yeah, imports are about all that's still being made. So, yeah, but I still think that niche MMOs are the wave of the future, considering, you know, Crowfall, Camelot Unchained, and Star Citizen, and yada, yada, yada.
Shroud of Avatar as well, and right. Shards that are making good progress. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
But they're all fitting into their own niche, as far as some are PvP focused, some are sandbox focused, some are just crazy experimental, like Shards, and yeah. So, interesting
Actually,
things
I know
to
what Western MMO released. Landmark.
Oh, that's not an MMO.
Yeah.
That's Minecraft 2.0. Like,
it's Minecraft 0.002.
Well, a prettier Minecraft, but maybe not as full featured.
It's not that pretty.
It's prettier than Minecraft. Minecraft is pretty much
Minecraft
the ugliest game on the market.
Minecraft can be pretty damn pretty if you chuck in a few texture packs, so don't knock Minecraft.
I don't like Minecraft, but anyway, I don't like Landmark either, so that's fine. So we're going to cut it short here. We've made it through a big chunk of the shows up to this point. We are going to end up skipping through quite a few more. And I know that towards the end of our list, because the shows are a lot more recent, it's not going to be something that we are going to want to reiterate too much on, because the content should be pretty fresh in people's minds. So we will be back in a few days. I'm going to get the second half of this thrown together, and we'll get it up for you for your listening pleasure shortly. We'll catch you guys in a few days.
That does it for this week's edition of Couch Potatoes. We hope you enjoyed it, and we hope that you'll continue to join us. Couch Potatoes can be found on Twitter at Couch Potatoes and on Anouk at anouk.com/blog/couch-potatoes. Music credits, other places you can find us, and pertinent links discussed on the show can be found in the show notes. Thanks for listening. We're going to get back to gaming now, so we'll see you next week.